Pokemon Connect for 2012. I'm here with Elliot Grant, and we're going to talk about item-level traceability and pallet traceability, I guess, for the fresh market,
yes.
Fresh foods and those kind of things. So why don't you just start off with that, and I'm interested in understanding just how that's done, because I know when I pick up a head of lettuce, I can't see the barcode.
Right. So that's a great example, actually. There are two initiatives in fresh produce. One is to track actually the case level, so that a 20-pound case of that head lettuce,
right,
as it goes from the farm through the distribution center to the store. And right now that's called the Produce Traceability Initiative, and it's been going for about 3 or 4 years based on GS1 standards, and the goal is to put a standardized label on every single case so that as it moves through the supply chain, each handler, each participant can record the product, the GTIN, and the lot number, and that lot number should identify where and when it was grown.
Okay.
So that when it reaches the store, even though you as a shopper can't tell where it came from, the retailer does. In the event of a recall, they can figure out if people are getting sick in that store, where did it come from, and where else did that product ship to. That's, I'd say, half of the problem.
Right.
You actually highlighted something very interesting. Shoppers actually want to know as well. So the other thing that's going on is item-level traceability. This is where that head of lettuce or a clamshell of strawberries will have a unique identity on it that allows you as a shopper to either type a code in on the web or even scan it with your cell phone, and you can see where it was grown, maybe when it was grown, and how it was grown. So we're actually answering two very different problems. One's a supply chain challenge, and one's a consumer marketing transparency challenge.
Right. In terms of practically applying labels, what kind of things are you using? Are these adhesive labels? Are they inkjet? Are they RFID? Are they
definitely not RFID? That's
okay.
A four-letter word in the fresh produce industry.
Oh, okay.
From a price point of view and from a usability point of view.
Right. Okay.
So they're primarily barcodes, and wherever possible, we try to use the existing label. So
think
of a watermelon with what is today a PLU label for price lookup. We augment that with a traceability code. So there's no additional label for the packer. A bag of salad is even easier. We basically modify the existing best by date and lot code that's already inkjet printed on the bag.
I see.
That now becomes a traceability code. So,
wherever possible, you modify that
or extend it?
Okay.
We extend it. So today, a bag of salad often has, you know, best by 10th of June, and then it'll have some unintelligible string of characters underneath it. We take that unintelligible string, we make it something that you can actually type into your cell phone.
Oh, I see. Okay. So you're not using 2D barcodes or 3D barcodes?
We are where we can, yeah. Okay. So bags of salad, for example, it's tricky to get a 2D barcode that's readable to auto-print, but a clamshell of strawberries or a watermelon, absolutely, we're using a QR code.
So what are the biggest challenges to getting this system implemented and accepted? I know GS1 obviously has the standard behind it. But
So let's go back to the two initiatives, the case level and the item. We'll separate those for a sec. And the case level PTI initiative is being driven by GS1, the Produce Marketing Association, United Fresh, the trade associations.
Right.
And it's a standard, and everybody can adhere to the same standard. And really the pull for that is the retailers saying, we want the system.
Right.
And it's on a multi-year path right now, and it's moving along. Probably about 20% of all cases today in the United States are compliant. So it's good. It's pretty good. We're into the early adoption phase.
Good.
The item level is really more driven by a brand who says, I want my brand to have this.
Right.
And so there you don't see everyone moving as one wave, but rather certain brands stepping up and saying, you know, I believe my brand deserves this level of transparency.
Okay. And so they're doing that, I guess initially as a marketing initiative to say we're ahead of the pack.
Yeah, so what we've discovered is very interesting. There are actually two reasons why a brand might adopt item-level traceability. One is I want to differentiate myself from the other salads or potatoes or pick your category.
Right.
But the more interesting angle perhaps is the data that is generated by consumer tracing is very insightful into the supply chain efficiency.
Okay.
We are actually able to see every time a shopper pulls out a cell phone and scans an item, for example, we're measuring where they are, when they did it, and how old the product is when it got there. So for perishable items, which might have a 10-day shelf life, knowing that it's 8.5 days old in New York is actually extremely important versus 6 days old in Los Angeles. So you can really begin to visualize your fresh supply chain as almost a byproduct of having shoppers engaging in a marketing activity.
So the shoppers are actually providing the feedback that drives then their efficiencies or alerts as to get the stuff out quickly or
absolutely. Not, yeah, so it's a wonderful kind of a, we think of it as a two-way street. So I, as a brand, I provide you the shopper information you care about, and by reading that information, you give me information that I care about, which is where and when is my product in the supply chain.
Great. All right. Well, I appreciate you coming in. It's fascinating. It's a lot going on. Something actually hits the consumers, too.
Exactly. And the next time you're in the grocery store,
I'm going to have my phone out.
Yeah, there you go.
All right. Thanks a lot. Very good.
Well, thank you.